Hi, folks. I'm Pastor Steve Herring, stated supply pastor at the Nahala Presbyterian Church, the Cobb Memorial Presbyterian Church, and the Pinetops Presbyterian Church in Pinetops, North Carolina. Today is Wednesday, the 5th of October, 2022, and we're going to do a little bit of Bible study. First, though, let us begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of this ancient word. We thank you for the gift of the ability to read this word. And we thank you for the ability to find meaning within it. We ask you, Lord, in all the situations, in all the troubles, in all the challenges that we might face, to help us to find that meaning always. Help us, Lord, to find the meaning, the value, the guidance that we need in the context of the challenges we face in this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, indeed, we are makers of meaning. Every minute that we're awake, out and about and doing, up and doing our thing, we're making decisions about what things mean. We had a storm just last week, and I remember I've joked around a little bit about that storm and saying that it was kind of a practice hurricane for us in Central North Carolina. We were very blessed that we did not have a lot of trouble. I was able to walk around and observe leaks. And of course, when you see a leak, you'll say, do I need to fix that right now or can I fix it later? And that's all about the meaning. You know, is this thing so important that I have to do it now or can I do it tomorrow? Or can I do it a week from tomorrow? Or must I take care of it this instant? And the answering that question, whatever it is, depends on what it means. It depends on the significance, the value, the meaning of what it is that's going on around us. And I believe, personally, that we today suffer from a crisis of meaning, a crisis of meaning. And so we watch various events and we formulate various explanations and various ways of describing the things that we see going on around us. And in that, we ascribe meaning. Listen to someone speak. Ascribe meaning to their words. See, if you don't ascribe meaning to their words, you would just ignore their words. We respond appropriately to that which has meaning. We ignore that which does not have meaning. So you can see that it's very important. What I'd like to do now is read you a passage from the 6th chapter of the Gospel according to John. I'm going to read to you, about 20 verses or 22 verses from the 6th chapter of John's Gospel. I'm going to start with verse 48, a teaching of Jesus that was controversial, difficult, paradoxical. A teaching of Jesus that really was troubling to those who first heard it. So I'm going to start off with John 6, verse 48. As I read these verses, think about the question of finding meaning. I will read from John 6, 48. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. Verse 52. The Judeans then argued amongst themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? And Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who eats me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not such as the fathers ate and died. He who eats this bread will live forever. This he said at the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Many of the disciples, when they heard it, said, this is a hard saying. Who can listen to this? But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples murmured at it, said to them, do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man, or the Son of Adam, ascending where he was before? It is the spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who those were that did not believe, who it was that would betray him. And he said, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. After this, many of his disciples drew back and no longer went about with him. Jesus said to the 12, do you also wish to go away? And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Now, the search for meaning, understanding what things mean. Now, the story, our story, the human search for meaning begins with hunger. Because one of the most basic, foundational, fundamental characteristics of being a human being is that if you don't eat, you get hungry. You get this feeling inside, this empty feeling. Oh, what is this feeling? Hunger. And we need to eat. So the meaning of hunger, it is intuitively obvious. What else has meaning that is intuitively obvious? Hunger and thirst. We're hungry, we know that we are hungry. We are thirsty, we know that we are thirsty. The meaning, you need food. The meaning, you need water. So defining stuff is easy in that regard. Now, this is a metaphor for the way we live. As you live every day. Now, If we were living in the ancient days, in a time of warfare, in a time of conflict, in a time of crisis, then the meaning of life every day would primarily be getting your food. It would primarily be, can you eat? Can you? Do you have food? Do you have water? Do you have a place to sleep where you're not going to get killed? You know, are you physically safe? And that basically was it. In civilization, as time went on and civilization evolved, people gradually spent less and less of their time and energy fighting for survival and fighting with one another. They spent less and less time doing that and more time living. I mean, if you think about it, that's basically what has happened to us as we have developed the ability to have and produce and distribute food and to have the rule of law and order, the basics of functional civilization such that we are not fighting and we have enough to eat, we have all this stuff. So therefore, we have time, energy, a moment to reflect and say, what does this all mean? What is the meaning of life? Jesus says, I am the bread of life. That is verse 48. That would be John chapter 6, verse 48. Now, I am the bread of life. That's what Jesus said. Now, that I am statement is a powerful statement. In John's gospel, the way I like to read John's gospel is to take each I am statement as a rubric. A rubric is a red letter statement. Rubric just means written in red. And in this case, I in the ancient books, you would have like capital letters written in red, which would be the rubrics, which would break down for you the structure of whatever argument or is being put in the book, right? Well, in John's gospel, when you read it, let the I am statements be rubrics. Let them be like the markers of an outline that shows you the structure of what is being said. And the other thing that can be in the same function as the I am statements, like this I am the bread of life, are me statements. Any of Jesus's statements of first person singular, me, when he uses that first singular pronoun. I take that as being right key in John's gospel to seeing the basic arguments that are being put forward. So, I am the bread of life. Now, remember, I am, from Exodus chapter 3, the name of God is I am. God is the great I am. And when we find these passages in John's gospel, we find a rich and powerful metaphor for our own self-identity, because that which Jesus is, we are. Take a well-known passage like Matthew 25, that you've known it, that you've given, done it unto these, the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you've done it unto me. The identification of the Savior, as in, you've done it unto me, with us, right? That you've done it unto the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you've done it unto me. The idea being that there is a common sense of identity between having to do with who and what we are, who and what Christ is. So there's a connection there. So I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they died. Manna in the wilderness. Now that's a biblical symbol, a biblical metaphor from the Old Testament, from the story of the Hebrews being fed in the desert with food that came down from the sky. Manna. Manna is that nourishment that is just provided. It's just there. Manna is a metaphor for the mercy, the love, the nourishment, all that is required for us to prosper in a physical sense. Jesus says the following. This is verse 50. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man eat of it and not die. The grace is what is necessary. The mercy, the goodness, the essence of living. See, we are not meant to simply struggle for survival and fight and smite. We're not meant to do that every moment of our existence. We are meant to understand what it is to be alive, what it is to be here now, what it is to speak the I am, to say, I am here now. Not only am I here, I may have the word of encouragement I need to share with my brother or my sister, therefore sharing not just a word, but the gift of life. Not just sharing a word, but sharing the gift of life and living. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. A founding belief, a basic element of faith that I hold personally is that once living, once we really understand what it is to be here now, when we understand and hold within ourselves the truth of I am, that is eternity in that moment. That is the key. That is like the doorway, like opening the crack in the box that lets us look inside and see what is eternal. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. That's the manna from heaven. That's the bread of Jesus. Jesus goes on, I am the living bread. That's a beautiful mixed metaphor. The living bread which comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. That is verse 51. I am the living bread that came down from heaven, and whoever eats this bread shall live forever. Unto the ongoing, unto the forever. The idea here being that the life we live in circumstantial conflict. And go back to what I said earlier about, you know, in the old days, all we really did was fight for survival. That was the whole business of living day after day after day, was a brutal, continual competition for what we needed to survive. Now, if that's what we have to do, is fight every day, then we're not really going to be able to live. Living is consciousness of living. Living without consciousness of living is just living automatically. And consciousness of living is something that these minds of ours are capable of doing, to step back from the immediate conflict of circumstances and say, I am. I live. I am here now, present in this moment, being mindful, being present, being alive in this instant transcends time and space. It is greater, bigger, larger, longer than time and space, that we're able to say, I am. Now that gift came to us through the ministry, life, and action of Jesus Christ. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever, and the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Judeans then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Now notice I translated that word Judeans. Very important when you read John's Gospel. John's Gospel and Matthew's Gospel in particular both have a strong anti-Semitic interpretation, which has been very unfortunate. And it's not wise to use the translation Jews because of the way that this particular group of people is made, constantly demonstrated in a negative way in John's Gospel. What's going on here is not to be taken as a racist or anti-Semitic a concept, but that is what has happened historically. This is a little change of subject, but whenever we read an ancient text, it is very important for us to understand that the ancient texts have often been misused or badly used in the past. And the anti-Semitic character of this text is something that has been abused. It's been misrepresented, misinterpreted, and misused. And what is necessary is to understand that Jesus lived in a very specific historic time of conflict, of religious and political conflict in Judea and in Galilee. The Judeans lived in Judea, the Galileans lived in Galilee. It's always worth remembering that Jesus was a Galilean and he did his ministry in Judea, and a lot of the reception of his work had to do with the conflicts that were occurring between Galileans and Judeans. It is therefore not wise for us to use the traditional translation Jews, because that implies or might imply to someone that makes reference to the Jewish people who live today. It doesn't. The current religious construction of the world, with Muslims and Jews and Christians and Hindus and Buddhists and atheists and all of the different ways that everybody looks at the world, that construction is modern. It's not the way things were when this old text was written. And so consequently, I find it a good idea, and I want to put it forth as a matter of record, John 6:52 and any other places in John's Gospel where the Greek word eudaios occurs, I will translate it Judean as in person of Judea, not person of the Jewish faith as we understand the Jewish faith today. I hope that makes sense, but I find that to be a very important minor observation. So, a little digression there. The Judeans then argued among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" And Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed." Verse 55. John 6, 55. Now, where it says indeed, true is the word. It's the alethes, true. My flesh is true bread, and my blood is true drink. Real bread, real drink. Now, this wonderful passage has, first of all, go back briefly to what I said about the conflict in Judea, the conflict between Jews and Samaritans, the conflict between Romans and Jews. The language here is very provocative to that conflict, because the way this language is constructed, the way this is said, is really very much saying, whoever eats my flesh, truly I say, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. That is very almost cannibalistic sounding language. And I will promise you that in the conflict specifically between Judeans and Romans, that was, these words were deeply troubling and very rhetorical as they were spoken at that time, to say that this is just going right to the whole notion of the purity of food, because the Torah, the commandments, were very much built around the purity of what one eats. And in fact, the whole Old Testament narrative is very much a narrative of purity. It's about cleansing. It's about washing. It's about purification. It's about purity. And so nothing was more impure to the ancient mind than the concept of cannibalism. And so this rhetoric, eat my flesh, drink my blood, this way of putting it, it is very provocative in guiding these original believers, actually the original believers, out of Judea in the Roman Empire, living as Roman believers, as Roman Christians. So where the text is pointing is in the direction of Roman Christianity, and where it is leading away from is Jewish purity. So that is the way this is set up. And it is, it's an incredibly difficult teaching. Okay, eats my flesh, drinks my blood. Well, you got to take it away from the physical into the spiritual and try to understand it's a metaphor, and you're talking about meaning. We're talking about the need for meaning. Everything we do has to have some level of meaning. And finding that level of meaning, especially when we're involved in all kinds of conflict and all kinds of division and all kinds of difficulty, finding that meaning can be very difficult. What the text is that by finding the meaning of the great I am by the metaphor, the teachings, the examples of Jesus Christ, we find life. We find life. Find life by finding meaning. That is what is being offered to us here. Many of the disciples, this is verse 60. Many of the disciples, when they heard it, they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to this? I can't listen to this. Ah, oh, this is terrible." Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples murmured or complained about it, he said to them, "Do you take offense at this? Is this a problem for you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no avail." Remember what I said. If you take these words as literal, then they're not going to have meaning, because, I mean, the literal interpretation of this text would be that he's advocating cannibalism. And there were people at that time who said that and used it for persecuting Christians. He's talking about a metaphor. He's talking about a way we have of finding meaning in the context of the meaninglessness of our troubles. That is where life is found. Jesus goes on, "The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life." And that's verse 63. "The words that I have spoken to you are it says here, "The flesh is of no benefit whatsoever. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life." So this whole teaching about eating the flesh of the Son of Man and drinking his blood is a spiritual teaching, a metaphorical teaching. It is a way of understanding, accessing the meaning in its essence, the meaning of life, the meaning that is exemplified for us by the life of Jesus, his life, his meaning. That is right there for us. And so we're right at verse 63. "It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is of no use at all, no benefit, no profit in the flesh. The words that I've spoken to you are spirit and life." What is a word? A word is a sound that has meaning. It's all about finding the meaning and holding that meaning. You see, life nourishment for the soul is meaning. You know, what does this mean? This means I love you. What does this mean? This means the sin is forgiven. What does this mean? This means you don't have to worry about that terrible burden that you were so concerned about. This means that your life, that you're living right now in this moment, is not limited to time and space, but rather the life you are living transcends all time and all space into eternity. It's that easy. It's called free grace. The grace is free by faith. All you have to do is believe. You just believe that, hey, I am alive. I am here. I am now. I am the child of God, the son of man, the son of humanity, the son of Adam. That I belong to a tradition of my prior believers, that my ancestors, that I belong to a tradition of the future, that I have a place, that my life has meaning, and that this meaning can be shared with other people. And finding that, you see, lifts us up out of the starvation and the thirst and the denigration and the desecration and the difficulty of living in constant conflict. That is what is being said here. And so, verse 66, after this, many of his disciples drew back and no longer went about with him. You see, the teaching, this teaching that Jesus is offering is becoming deeply metaphysical, deeply spiritual, deeply symbolic, deeply metaphorical. And folks don't want that. They want the political, hey, will you help us kill Romans or not? You know, that was what they wanted. Will you help us with the war against Rome or not? You know, that purely physical level of, you gonna do it or not, commitment or not. And that level is not the level, you know, that produces great difficulty. Jesus wasn't teaching on that level. He was teaching on a spiritual level. If we could just realize that, we could put aside so much of the conflict and all the acrimony that is going on around us today. Jesus says to the 12, do you also wish to go away? That's verse 67. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. You have the words of eternal life. You have the words of eternal life. Words which mean eternal life. That's what we need. If we have the words of eternal life, if we can just have that spark with us, that ability with us, that ability to help those we are with to understand that they will live forever, eternity. That which is cannot not be. That which is. I am is a permanent status, exclusive of I am not. Now, certainly there will be a time when I will not be here. There will be a place, there are all kinds of places where I will not be. Because I understand the temporary and fragile nature of my existence, but I am in this moment. It's I am, it is I live, I exist here and now. In this moment, I think, I exist, I am here. Eternity. Eternity is here. Eternity is not over there, not out there, not down there. Eternity is right here, with you. Where you are in your current circumstances. And yes, the current circumstances can be really difficult. They were then in the old days. They are difficult today. But by the Spirit, we can live. We can realize that once alive, always alive. Once in Christ, always in Christ. Once forgiven, always forgiven. To take the gift of life and live the gift of life. That's what this scripture offers us. And I hope you can see that, and I hope you can accept it, and I hope it brings you a blessing. Nelson Johnston, I believe, will be preaching here in Pinetops on Sunday. I will be preaching at Cobb at 11 o'clock and at Nahala at 9:30. I want to encourage you to do several things. Send me feedback. Feedback is important. Email me with any thoughts, questions, suggestions, or ideas that you may have. Let your friends know to subscribe to this YouTube channel, and we'll continue this process of the study of Scripture. I'm Pastor Steve Herring, and I will look for you on Sunday.